With this book, we're entering the final quarter, the last 25%. When I began this project, I really didn't know much about the franchise, and now I know too much. I'm doing things like recognizing subgenres. For example, this book, The Legend of the Lost Legend, fits into a very specific subgenre within R.L. Stine's writing, along with other Goosebumps stories like Attack of the Mutant, A Shocker on Shock Street, and The Beast from the East. A genre I like to call,
I don't know, I'm making it up as I go, throw some random shit in there, kids will buy it regardless, who cares?
These types of books are somehow both uninspired and inspired at the same time. Uninspired because I don't believe Stine put an ounce of thought through their construction, but inspired because there are no trains of logic and you are constantly met with unexpected imagery. Just page after page of what? Today's book opens in medias res, with siblings Justin and Marissa Clark in Antarctica in search of the rare blue sea lion. A thrilling adventure involving ice floes and runaway dog sleds. Oh, oops, except it's all a story Justin and Marissa's dad is telling to them around the campfire. Oh well, we'll just throw the first two chapters in the trash and get to the real story. Dad and his two kids are camping in the forest of Brovania, a fictional European country. I hear Brovania is where all the vampires and fraternities live. Dad is an author and a story collector, a guy who goes around the world and publishes stories from other cultures for profit. Here in Brovania, he's looking for the Lost Legend, a centuries-old manuscript locked in a silver chest and hidden somewhere in this vast forest. Nobody knows who wrote it, and nobody knows what's on it. So, why does anyone care? If it was the Lost Fifth Gospel of Christ or an unpublished Chaucer manuscript, then you would have something concrete to speculate on and a goal to get excited over. But the way the Lost Legend is framed is like going, oh, there's rumors of a lost yellow legal pad in a briefcase out in the wilderness somewhere. Nobody knows who it belongs to or what's written on it. Maybe it's Al Capone's secret will and testimony. Maybe it's a bunch of doodles of penises. It could be anything. Like, why would you care? The Clark family settles into their tent for the night, but not before Justin, who's our POV character for the book, knocks over a kerosene lantern and sets a tiny bit of the tent on fire. They put it out easy enough, but it's clear that Dad is just fucking done with these kids. Everything is fine, Dad said softly, still fiddling with the tent wall. But no thanks to either of you, he added sourly. Huh? What do you mean? I demanded, straightening a leg of my pajama pants. You haven't been much help, Dad complained. What did I do? Marissa asked shrilly. I didn't try to burn the tent down. You wandered off and got lost this morning, Dad reminded her. I thought I saw a weird animal, Marissa replied. Then tonight you both refused to get firewood, Dad accused. We were tired, I explained, and we didn't know where to look, Marissa added. In a forest, Dad cried. You don't know where to look for firewood in a forest. How about on the ground? Dad was getting steamed. Wow, Dad? Why do you keep telling us stories about your children perishing in the wilderness? So after that rather unpleasant parenting moment, everyone gets in the tent for sleep. Dad falls asleep instantly, and he's one of those people who's impossible to wake up. The kids, however, are pretty restless, and are awoken soon after by howling. Stepping out to investigate, they find a large white dog, or perhaps a wolf. It seems friendly enough, and has a note tucked into its collar. I know why you're here. Follow Silver Dog. They do, waltzing into the forest in the middle of the night, Silver Dog leading them to a cabin. Inside, they meet Ivana, a very large woman wearing a long, flowing gray dress. She had flashing, bright green eyes. Blonde bangs fell across her forehead, and long braids hung down the sides of her round-cheeked face. Her arms were big, with powerful muscles. She had sparkling rings on each finger. Oh, hello. So, is there a Mr. Ivana in your life? Ivana is nice, if boisterous and prone to playing pranks, you know, like every character in Goosebumps ever. She wants to help the kids find what they're looking for, but to do so, they need to survive a test in Fantasy Forest. That's actually what it's called. To help them with the test, the kids are introduced to Luca, a snarling, hairy man who is raised by wolves. Luca will guide them through this vague test in the morning. Justin and Marissa fall asleep and wake up in a field bordering the forest. As with all books in the,
I don't know, I'm making it up as I go, throw some random shit in there, kids will buy it regardless, who cares,
genre, recapping Legend of Lost Legend feels like you're writing a listicle, as set pieces feel largely separated and don't blend into each other that well. And it's all weird, and there's no point to any of it. Early on, the kids lose track of Luca and wander into a part of the forest with eggs littered across the ground. Dozens of mice hatch from the eggs and swarm the kids, who discover that these are actually robot mice with an off switch on their bellies. And yeah, credit where it's due, mice hatching from eggs is a striking visual, and if you're one of many people already creeped out by rodents, I could see this being a very effective horror scene. But it's just so random. It feels like Stein dreamed this scene some time before, put it in a break glass when you have no ideas case, and finally used it here. The one common element these set pieces have is that the fantasy forest is entirely artificial. The trees are made out of plaster, there is a visible plug on the bottom of a turbulent stream. Something's up. The one bit of proper setup and payoff in this book comes when Justin and Marissa are attacked by two giant cats. Not wild cats, but like King Kong-sized house cats. And look, it's another one of those moments where some kid reading it discovered their vor fetish. The tongue rolled beneath me, shedding me in darkness. Oh, so hot and wet inside, so hard to breathe, I heard low gurgling and growling below me in the cat's stomach. No, I cried. No, 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 no! My voice sounded tiny and muffled inside the cat's mouth. I mean, y'all need Jesus. But okay, Justin took some of those mechanical mice from earlier, so he turns them back on and the mice distract the cats long enough for the kids to escape. It really is the only setup and payoff in the whole book. I know I'm speeding through a lot of this book, but none of it means anything. Most of these scenes could come in any order without really changing anything. Whatever idea you might have as to the nature of the fantasy forest and the creatures within is way more interesting than what the book comes up with. Eventually, the kids make their way back to Ivana's cabin, only to find her slumped over. Investigating, they realize that she, too, is mechanical, an incredibly advanced robot. Luca then comes in and starts taking off his makeup. He wasn't some wild wolf man after all, but the one in charge, the one who made the fantasy forest. Now you're probably expecting a twist reveal that this is some sort of candid camera reality show, or that the kids stumbled onto a weird in-development theme park by mistake and Luca was using the kids to test the attractions. You might even go so far as to guess that it's fully copying a Shocker on Shock Street, and the kids are also robots. Yeah, but it's none of those things. But why? I choked out. Why did you build all that?
As a test, Luca replied simply. So many people come to the forest. They come searching for all kinds of treasures, just as you two have. My family has lived in this forest for hundreds of years. It became our job to protect many of the treasures. And so we built a test forest to keep out those who are unworthy, to stop the people who don't deserve the wonderful treasures.
So it's still the trials seen in fantasy fiction, but instead of magic, it's Disneyland? But the magical treasures themselves are real and magic is real, but... And what is even being tested? The children's bravery, their intelligence, their strength of heart? Luca says it's their ability to determine what's real and what's not, but like, you made a forest of plaster trees that are easily pushed over by children. You gave the robot mice visible off switches. It's less Justin and Marissa's capabilities and more Luca's shoddy craftsmanship. And that somehow makes them worthy of
getting a priceless magical treasure? Whatever. Luca gives them the silver chest, and the kids return to camp, presenting the chest to Dad. Everyone's excited, but when they open it, they find, not the lost legend, but some kind of weird egg. Well, they're white and American, so they return to the cabin and ask to see the manager. Luca is embarrassed. Oh shit, the lost legend? I thought you were out here for the Eternal Egg of Truth. Totally the wrong magical mystical treasure, my bad. Sure you don't want the egg? It's pretty sweet. This is the best part of the book. It's an amusing idea that this guy has so many treasures that he easily mixes up what people are looking for, and that this family is so petty as to not appreciate the seemingly powerful artifact they were given. It's the book's one good idea. So Luca takes the egg back and points Dad to a small group of wanderers living out in the woods. When the Clark family approaches them and asks for the lost legend, the wanderers immediately pack up, hand over the old manuscript, and get out of there as quickly as possible. They soon find out why when Dad reads the inscription on the first page. Whoever owns the lost legend will be lost forever. And indeed, Dad, Justin, and Marissa realize they have no idea where they are. So, yeah, I don't know what this book was trying to do. It's a mess of vague elements mushed together incohesively. The horror in this horror book is random nonsense. The characters are flat. Stein isn't commenting on anything here. He's not making twisted fairy tales because he doesn't draw from any real world fairy tales or mythologies or fantasy epics. There is this super vague, non-committed Norse thing. Ivana has this Viking woman ensemble, including the historically inaccurate horned helmet, but nothing resembling Norse mythology is present. I don't know, I feel like I've been rambling this whole time. Let's get to the rewrite and see if I can't wrangle these criticisms in a bit that way. First off, characters and their motivations. Justin and Marissa are largely blank slates. The book doesn't even do that classic Goosebumps thing where one of the siblings is a brat and plays pranks all the time. We don't know their interests, we don't know what they're afraid of, and besides gender, there's just nothing separating the two kids. Their motivations are off too. Neither of them are all that interested in the lost legend itself. That's Dad's thing. And Dad is absent for most of the book. Instead, Justin is motivated in finding the lost legend to please Dad, to make Dad proud of him. Now, you could do something with that, either as a children's parable about obeying your parents, or suggesting that Dad is being too harsh and patriarchal. But this book doesn't do either, and it's just an excuse to get some dumb kids to follow a wolf into the forest. So let's reconfigure these characters. Justin is a total fantasy and fairy tale nerd. He's always got a head in some book. He plays Dungeons and Dragons at school and probably gets beat up for it. And he's constantly coming up with his own fantasy worlds. In contrast, Marissa is a total science nerd. She's always got her head in some nature magazine. She's taking advanced for her age science classes in school. And she's always calling animals and plants by their Latin name. The two siblings have polar opposite interests and are often in conflict about it, giving the characters both contrast and two sets of skills that are both useful in the story to come. Also, the older boy being into unicorns and elves and the younger sister being into biology and chemistry is a fun switcheroo from most children's media. Dad is no longer in search of the lost legend. He's just brought the kids out for a European camping vacation. And instead of a fictional country, we're going to Germany. Yeah, that takes us away from the Nordic parts of the continent, but Stein didn't do anything with that Viking shit anyway. Germany gives us Little Red Riding Hood, Snow White, Rapunzel, Hansel and Gretel, the Frog Prince, a lot of stuff young American readers will recognize. Justin is excited to come. This is the country of the Brothers Grimm. Meanwhile, Dad is a shallow tourist who just wants a couple of hollow Kodak moments, and Marissa is mostly interested in the wildlife and maybe pop by the birth home of Albert Einstein. So we've got these richer characters and a much richer setting, so let's give us a richer plot. The rewrite opens with the Clark family taking a pit stop in a small German village, the last piece of civilization before they hike into the forest to camp. In the town is a small, dusty, easy-to-overlook shop of curiosities, full of strange items relating to fairy tales and folklore, and the walls are covered with hundreds of beautiful, strange, ornate cuckoo clocks, each depicting fantastic scenes of children and fairy tale creatures. Wait, did that little child figure on that one clock move? Must have been my imagination. The shopkeeper is a classic, old, off-putting eccentric, who also built all these cuckoo clocks. He sees how interested Justin is with everything, and makes a passing joke about them going into the forest to find the lost legend. Justin asks what that is, and the shopkeeper tells of an old manuscript that tells the reader their whole life story, including their future. Many people have looked for it over the centuries, even the Brothers Grimm, and many of those people disappeared. But it's said the lost legend is hidden somewhere in this very forest. Justin leaves, but can't get his mind off this lost legend thing. So now the lost legend actually is something. You can't really care about something when you don't know what it is, right? And Justin, our protagonist, is actually interested in the lost legend. Justin wants to quest for it, even if he doesn't know how. That night, when everyone is asleep, the kids are woken up by howls, they step outside, they find a breadcrumb trail, and follow it to a house made of gingerbread and candy in the middle of the woods. Instead of a witch, we meet Ivana, because giant woman! And she gives our kids their first clue in tracking down the lost legend. From here, the kids go through a series of set pieces connected to German fairy tales. They get chased around by the big bad wolf, they have a run-in with the seven dwarves who turn out to be pretty nasty, etc., etc. Really, the point to the rewritten version of this book is that these are fairy tales that young readers will be familiar with, recontextualized as something scary and threatening. Justin is able to get out of these situations with his foreknowledge of the fairy tales at hand, but it's Marissa and her scientific mind that realizes that the forest is fake. The trees are made of plaster. There's a plug in the stream. The fairy tale creatures are mechanical, not full robots, but clockwork automatons, full of gears. Both Justin and Marissa's skill sets have to be combined to figure out what's going on. Finally, they find the silver treasure chest, and inside, the lost legend. Yeah, we lose that moment of accidentally finding the wrong treasure, which was the original book's best moment by far, but best to have a better book overall than to keep this one good element. So, Justin and Marissa start to read the manuscript, and it starts with the opening paragraph of this very book. Justin and Marissa can't stop reading. There's something magical about this that keeps their eyes glued to the page. And now they are trapped, reliving these events over and over and over again. The lost legend resetting them to the beginning of this very book. We pull back from Justin and Marissa, and the scene reveals itself as part of a cuckoo clock. A cuckoo clock depicting the events of the book. The candy cottage, the chase from the wolf, the encounter with the dwarves. Moving as part of the clock mechanisms, moments repeating themselves over and over again. The shopkeeper smiles at his new creation and mounts it on the wall. So this, I think, retains much of the original book as possible while giving it interesting characters, developed stakes, and more thematic purpose. There's other avenues to explore if, say, you ditched the forest is fake idea for something else, but I wanted to see what I could make with that limitation. It really doesn't feel like Arl Stein was trying with Legend of the Lost Legend. It's empty in its randomness, hollow in its strangeness, and while there's an interesting idea here and there, Stein never knows what to do with those. Pretty much in line with the rest of the,
I don't know, I'm making it up as I go, just throw some random shit in there, kids will buy it regardless, who cares, books.
I give Legend of the Lost Legend a cold French fry that fell under the driver's seat out of 10.